you to see the video than it does in a very small square. So without any further ado, let me share my screen here. So I'd like to very much thank Hedra for joining in tonight. He's got an excellent story about getting into budgies, and I guess we'll get it started. Hedra, you hiding there somewhere? Can you hear me okay? Hedra, maybe on mute.
Can you hear me now?
Oh, yes, I can hear you now.
That's good. Okay.
Perfect. How are you going, mate?
Very good.
Excellent.
Very good.
Thank you again for doing this interview.
Oh, thank you. Thank you. I didn't realize how much work you put into these things. I've done the one, and it was a lot of work. You do it every month. So, and it's great service you're doing for the hobby there. And these videos will remain there for the future generations.
Here's the hoping.
Yeah.
So
yeah.
Now, Hedra, can you give us a little bit of a background before we jump into looking at your different lines and talking about your interviews? Just a little bit of background about how you got into budgies.
So I got into budgies as a teenager back in Egypt. I think I got my first pair as a birthday present. And then our neighbors had budgies and they were breeding, and mine didn't breed. So, and then I decided to get mine to breed like our neighbors. So I kept working with them and they started breeding. And then I got into the English budgies back in Egypt still as a teenager. And then I had to give them up when I started working. Yeah.
And how long have you been in budgies back here in Australia?
Well, I've acquired my first stock in 2011. I came to Australia 2010, bought my first stock in 2011, and bred my first budgie in 2012. So 9 years.
9 years into the hobby and you're a champion breeder. That's an excellent effort, mate. Well done.
Thanks.
Tell us about your first aviary here in Australia. What did you, was it a very elaborate setup?
It wasn't really an aviary. So I was still in a rental property, and there are obviously restrictions on what you can do in rental properties, but there was a pergola, and I've closed it off with some sheets to provide some shielding for the birds. And I just bought some holding cages, different sizes, stacked them on top of each other under the pergola, and just had a go.
Nice. And I believe after that you went into a tin shed, is that right?
Yeah, that was upgrade. The tin shed was a fair bit of an upgrade over the pergola. So that was my first ever, that was my own place. It was on a 450 square meter block with a very small yard. So I can only fit a small tin shed there. And I bought one of those off the shelf sheds, erected it myself, and done the best I can do to make it habitable for the budgies.
And this budgie here, Hedra, is this one of the ones that you bred in that tin shed?
Not just this. This was one of them, but I bred a lot of good birds in the tin shed. All the foundation was bred in the tin shed.
I think that would be very, very assuring for a lot of the beginners that are watching tonight.
Yeah.
Know that you can breed birds of that quality inside of a tin shed. Jumping forward, tell us a little bit about the evolution of the stud. 9 years, and these are the kind of birds that you're breeding.
Oh yeah. So, look, I was very lucky, but there are mainly two lines, as we'll see. There's a spangle line, and there's another line that I call light green line, or it's really a sky blue line. They kind of evolved in parallel, but they cross paths. And when they cross paths, they produce the best birds. Yeah.
So tell us a little bit about this line that we're looking at here. This is the Spangle line.
Yes, yes. So that's the Spangle line. It's a bit more recent than the other line, than the green or the blue line, if you like. So when I started, I had a lot of birds from so many different sources. I didn't have the luxury to be able to buy. Oh, it's not just a luxury, but even the connections. I didn't know anyone. I didn't know where to start and how what to do. If I'm to start again, I would have done it a bit differently. But bought birds from all over the place, and tried different things. And one of the pairings that clicked was a Gary Gazzard Spanglecock to Kev O'Callaghan Double Factor Hen, and they bred a number of strong chicks. Most of them were double factors. So one of the double factors won the shield class as an adult. So, but I find it a bit tricky to work with double factors. So I moved them on and I kept the single factor spangle, and that became the foundation bird. So the single factor spangle, was still fertile and kicking for a number of years, and was paired to many hens. But it was a pairing again to a Bob Smith hen, which bred very interesting chicks.
So that's the cockbird we're looking at here, the light green of yours, is that correct?
That is the light green there. Yep, that is the one. Yep. And from that light green, I bought the Spangle, which went to Mackay Nationals. It's a very young bird, about 6 months old, done very well. Had a lot of good feedback on this bird. And I bred also a number of siblings who were the foundation of this Spangle line, basically. So that's one of the siblings we're looking at there. Gray-green Spangle cock. Had a beautiful face and very glowy, but was more a white feathered bird. And what I've learned was to try and get the white feathered birds and pair them to long feathered birds to get basically the face bigger, longer and wider.
Now, when you're talking about a wide feather, where are you pulling the feather out on the bird to look at it? Out of the mask, out of the body?
I don't really pull the feather. I just look at the shape of the feather on the on the crown of the bird. Yep. So if you look at the frontal, you can tell how wide and round the feathers are. So that bird was actually paired to a Craig Barnett hen, which was exactly that. She was a very long and blowy feathered hen. She didn't have the width and the roundness in the face like him, but she was a very blowy and long feathered hen with a deep mask. And you can see the influence of the hen. So the chicks have got the cap width and the directional feather of the dad, but you can see the masks are getting quite deep and the feathers are getting long. So this was a joint pairing with Craig. So these are the two chicks that I picked and carried on with. The cockbird then done well as a show bird. He ran second in Victoria and second and third in two consecutive years in the light green classes. Then the way to go with this was again to try and repeat the same type of pairing. So the chicks were long and wide, but so with this bird, he was more a long feathered bird. So he was paired to a Glen Sheila hen, which is again was a 50% Bob Smith. So keeping that Bob Smith blood always at 50%. And she was more short and white feathered hen. And again, getting that result, getting the face bigger again. So you get some of the chicks will have the width and the length again. And the hen was an interest.
So to give everyone a bit of an idea here, Hadra, how far in, like we talked 2012, you bred your first birds, talking 2014, it's pairing.
2014, yep. 2014, I bred a spangler, yep. Mackay National, so this bird would have been 2016, 2017.
Yep, and then what are we talking about here?
2018.
What sort of age?
2018, yep.
So 6 years into the evolution of the stud, and you're breeding these birds here, correct?
Absolutely, yeah, yeah. Yep. And there's only four birds from the pair, and three out of the four were looking like that. And yep. The hen was also a show winner. I've just shown her as a UBC, and she ran Supreme UBC in show. He was, I don't think he's done very well every time I show him too. Only showed him in the shields. So yeah, and the hen was again paired to a Glenn Schiller cock, again 50% Bob Smith out of the same line. And that was a key pairing. So she's bred the lovely Spangle that won the shield class in Victoria.
That's this guy here, a reference to Pretty Boy.
Yes, that's what I call him, Pretty Boy. I just thought he was pretty. Sisters ran second in the shield down at the bottom.
Yep.
Spangle, Opaline Spangle, hasn't yet started showing him, but very good budgie. And this was the next generation. Some chicks started dripping out. Now, Pretty Boy has passed away, but I'm confident the siblings will carry on producing the same.
And
same
obviously, son there as well.
That's so. A son, yeah. Son is a good budgie too. Probably not the best photo. He was still too young. So that's
so let's have a look at this guy. Tell us what you like about him, Hedra.
So that's him, Pretty Boy there. A few things I like about him. The thickness through the body, the depth of chest, got a bit of shoulder. That buffalo effect that widths across the sear. A bit of feather length too, you know, a bit of blow. Generally strong presence in the show bird, not a small budgie, good size budgie.
I think when you say a bit of blow and a bit of this, you're being very conceited there, Hedra. He's an exceptional budgie. Well done.
Yeah, he's all right. Yeah.
He's all right.
Yeah.
All right, let's take a look at the other half of your spangle line here.
That's another branch. So again, same pair, same light green spangle cock.
Yep.
That's now a daughter of him, so sister to the Mackay Spangle.
Yep.
That's paired to another Glenn Schiller bird out of the same spangle cock of Pop Smith. So I had three of them that I swapped with both Craig and Glenn. And that's a daughter there. That pairing has bred a number of chicks, and they were all exceptional. The hens, especially from that pairing, were very strong. I don't think we just have enough time in this presentation to show the different what the different hens has bred. So I just picked the best one of them. So this hen was the most successful, but there was about six or seven hens who looked the same and also were very successful. So that is this cinnamon spangle hen. Again, very good bird on the show bench, opposite sex to best young bird in show when I showed her, and in the shield was a reserve in the team. And I paired her to two different cockbirds and bred exceptional quality chicks in the two different pairings. So the
one up the top here you've referenced as Magic Pudding, is that right?
Yes, so that's come from this hen paired to a Bob Smith Spangle.
Yep.
We call it the Hills Spangle, so that's a terminology me and Craig use to differentiate the different Bob Smith birds. So that was the Bob Smith cock that Craig bought at Hills auction, and I later borrowed this bird or swapped it for the big gray cock that we will see in the next slide. And look, the birds were exceptional qualities. They were both big, powerful birds, but the chicks were average, were very disappointing comparing to the quality of the pair. And that finds that that's something that happens often. You put two super birds together and you breed average chicks. But what I find, you hang on to these birds and you pair them back to the family and the quality will come out. So anyway, so the best cock that came out of the pairing didn't look anything special. I got over myself and used it. And I paired it to, again, a hen, nothing special, came out of the other line. And I bred only two chicks. One was a very big light green, which I moved on, didn't have a tail. And the other one I kept a slightly lesser but more complete budgie, which is this one here. And
that's, buddy,
you're talking about? Yeah, yeah. Not a complete budgie by any means, but is, we'll see him in the video, is big buffy bird, but the chicks that he breeds, and he ran third in the Spangler class in Victoria, so he's not bad, but the chicks that he's breed, that he's been throwing, is just way better than himself. Just always breed big frame birds with very long feathers. It's three different hens I paired him to. Two of them are related and one unrelated, and he seemed to just be putting this frame and feather lens on the chicks from every hen.
I think it's very clear, obviously, going from the left-hand side of the screen to the right-hand side of the screen, that the birds have improved dramatically.
How's the feather lens? You can see it on the feather lens. The feather is getting longer and longer. Yes, yes, absolutely. And you can see that the quality drops a generation. So the original light green spangle, the hen, that the daughter is nothing to look at, but then her chicks, the quality came back. And then if you look at the top pairing, the son is nothing to look at, but then you use again and go back again to the family and then you get it back and more.
Yeah.
And then at one stage, then it kind of stays there.
Let's have a look at that spangle cock, shall we?
So no, that's not the good one on top right is a bit in a molt, so I couldn't, but the other one was looking all right, the baby. This is at 7 months old, so.
Tell us what you like about this bird, Hedra.
Oh, as a baby, he was a handful bird. He felt very good in the hand as a baby. So he's got some bone structure about him. Nothing, probably you can't see it inside the show cage. You need to hold the bird in the hand. But he feels really good in the hand, very strong bones, long keel, long cap feathering, a bit of which, fully feathered bird, which is always tricky to have when you've got this feather lens. They tend to have feather issues, so it's always lucky to get one with the feather lens and tail and flights. It seemed to be an issue with this type of birds.
It's a very nice bird. Let's have a look at a few of the birds from your line.
This is other birds from that line.
So this is the brother to the Mackay Spangle, correct?
Yep. That was a key breeder, this one.
Yep. What about this hen here?
She's 50% from the other line. She's a daughter of the big grey cock paired to a hen from the Spangle line, yes.
Yep.
And that is a hen that was paired to the Glenshiller cock.
Yep, so this one's a sister to the Mackay hen, is that right?
Correct.
The Mackay cock.
Yep. And the one on the top right is one of the daughters. The two hens at the bottom left are also two more daughters from that pairing.
Yep.
The big gray green hen was opposite six to best young bird in show and opposite six to grand champion, second in the gray green class. I think third or fourth in the hens class. She's also out of that line from the big gray cock bear to a spangle hen from that line. She's sister to the big light green spangle hen.
Yep. Let's have a look at a few more here. So we've got a few gray green spangles here. Walk us through these.
So the gray green spangle is a second or third generation chick. The one top left is one of the hens I bred out of that pairing, the spangle hen, light green spangle hen to the Glenshiller cock. That is obviously what the line is look like is looking like now, six generation down the line. So the latest model is in the middle at 7 months old. This top right, another hen from the pairing of the original hen to the Glenn Schiller cock. Top right in the corner, that's an interesting photo. So that shows the original cock, gray-green spangled cock at the left, and the one in the next generation from his sister pair to the Glenn Schiller cock. And it's like a bigger version of the original one. So you can see in the lines, one generation, second generation, how they have kept all the top end features, but just the size has become a lot bigger. And this picture tells the story of the influence of the Glenn Schiller birds. They were just so bulky. And they bred
this. We'll look at a few more here. So this one here is obviously Magic Pudding.
That's Magic Pudding. So that's maybe five generations down the line.
This one here is the Mackay
Cock. Yep. This is the cinnamon spangle hen is from the same light green spangle cock, the original one, paired to a different Bob Smith hen. Now, you get the directional feather and a bit of shoulder, but the feather was quite short. I would call this a fine feathered bird. I moved her on. This was a mistake. This was the original spangle was a white feathered bird, and the other Bob Smith hen I paired him to was a very similar looking hen. Also a short white feathered hen. And you just get these short feathered birds. They look lovely in the photos, but in real life, they are nowhere near the power of the long feathered and blowy ones.
Hedrick, tell me, this cockbird here, is it true you're breeding budgerigars for about 5 years? He places at the Nationals. Is it true you moved this guy on at an auction?
Yeah, that was sold in Newcastle auction. Yeah, that's true, yeah.
You must have had a great deal of confidence in the birds at that point to be moving on a bird of that caliber. That's a very good spangle.
Well, the brother, I had two brothers who are not far off, and they were very, very aggressive cockbirds. So I had no doubt that the brothers will breed a lot of chicks over a number of hens. And I can see that the line is forming, and I knew that I would be able to piece it back together. And I was very pleased when I saw Pretty Boy, because he was just the next level up and two generation down.
So, yeah, you're certainly going on with it and taking them forward.
So yeah, it was reassuring to see that that birds of this caliber and better are still popping out.
Now this hen here, you said, is a sister to Pretty Boy, correct?
That's his sister. Yeah. She ran second this year in the Young Bird Shield. She's done well. Yeah.
Yeah, and that's a big spangle.
Yeah, that's the best son of Magic Pudding. He's unfortunately in a big molt at the moment. I couldn't take a good video. I've showed him once in Melton. He had a Melton diploma. He had a dodgy tail, so he didn't progress past winning the spangle class, but everyone saw the type of budgie he was.
Yeah. Obviously a very good one.
Yeah.
Now this guy down here, this is the brother to Pretty Boy, is that correct?
Yeah, and that was just him breaking his cap. He hasn't filled out yet. The photo on top next to Pretty Boy on the right is the same bird after he's matured a bit more.
And you've got to tell us about this hen down here. She looks exceptional.
So she's one of the chicks. So this hen and Magic Pudding, as well as this bird, the big spangle, second top on the left, they are all from the crossing between the light green line and the spangle line.
So let's have a look at this light green line then.
Yeah.
So this is the green line. Explain what we're looking at here.
So this is the oldest line. So this is the line that started in 2012. There are now seven, eight generations going now. So this is where most of the work has gone. So 2012, I bred this spangle out of a Mark Chiddell bird that I bought from Jeff Gardiner, if he's attending or he may be seeing this. The Mark Chiddell bird was very helpful in a way. He showed me what can And I was just starting, and I had birds from 20 different sources at that time. But I've had this bird, and I was looking at the different birds, and I kind of started forming up a view on what kind of budgie I want to breed based on this bird. It was this bird that clicked for me, and I was like, okay, this is, I want to breed birds that look like that. This was the start. This was me starting to have a view on what sort of budgie I want to breed. So I had him with a very average hen. I didn't do the bird justice, to be honest, but the chicks were still pretty good. So that is the one that survived, the gray-green spangled cock. Back then, obviously, it was still my first year, and setup was very average. So I didn't have the knowledge to keep them alive and look after them in the way that I do now. So anyway, that was the one that left and bred well. And I tried to keep this look, but obviously Mark Chidell was retired from the hobby. It was very hard to get any birds that look like the original birds. So I started looking outside for birds that look like the original Chidell birds, and there were the Gary Gazzard birds. They were the birds that really had the strong similarities to the original Chidell bird. So back then I didn't know Gary Gazzard or anything. I was just looking at the birds that were coming to Victoria for auctions, and I noticed the similarity in the head features, in the wings, in the deportment areas and all that. So, but they were out of my budget back then. So I was just buying whatever Gary Gazzard birds that were landing within my budget without even looking at them at that time. So the Spangle was paired to a Gary Gazzard hen that I bought in Hills Auction.
So that's his pairing down here?
Correct. And that was a key pairing. Correct. But every chick that came out of this pairing was a keeper. They were all big, strong shouldered birds with nice faces. So the best of them was paired to a Jeff Edwards sky blue cock that I bought in Western Auction. Again, I was buying most of my birds in the auctions. I didn't have the connections to buy birds directly from breeders. So auctions were a blessing for me because it gave me the opportunity.
I don't think you go wrong with Jeff Edwards. He's a good, honest Aussie here in SA.
I didn't know anything. I just bought the bird. The bird had a magnificent head on it, but he bred me a lot more than just a good head. That bird was a lucky strike for me because pairing to that hen. And one thing I do when I get a good outcross, you will notice that I throw my best birds at them. So I got the Jeff Edwards hen. The Spangled Opaline hen was my best bird at that time. Yeah. So I threw my best hen at him. And that was, again, that was a very significant pairing because the chicks that I got from the pair were not just nice faced or nice heads. Some of these birds were massive and most of them were good size. So the gray
this gray cock up here, he was bred from the Jeff Edwards cock.
Yep.
And the Edric Amel rung hen out of the Gazzard Chidell cross.
Correct.
Tell us about this gray cock bird.
So that obviously was an evolution for me to breed that bird. And I couldn't believe I bred something that good. When he was in the nest, it was like unreal for me to see something like that. I was very pleased. I kept him as a young bird, didn't show him a lot. I started showing him as an adult. I think he probably wasn't beaten as an adult, won a number of best adult in show, won the gray class in the shield. His brother ran second in the gray class. Spangle hen, his sister, won the Spangle class in the UBC shield, probably won it in the adult shield as well. They were all big, powerful birds. So the gray cock also has bred me a number of birds that placed very well in the shield and done very well on the show bench. I probably, when I started breeding with the chicks from the gray cock, I didn't notice the immediate improvement. They were too good already. It was hard to push more. So I was a bit impatient and inexperienced at that time, just 3-4 years into the hobby. So I moved on most of the chicks from the gray cock, probably in hindsight, probably a mistake. So I didn't leave many of them. But one of the daughters, which was a gray green hen paired to a Bob Smith cock, Bob Smith light green cock, has bred me the sky blue cock, which is a bird that I fell in love with when he was in the nest. Had a lot of things, had a head to die for, and he had a gray green hen, which was a very big bird as well. But
so that's like, this one here.
Yeah, she was she was a bit coarse feathered. She was much bigger, but she had some feather issues. It was a bit harder to get in condition and breed with. He was just a happy budgie chasing hens all the time. So, and I love cockbirds like that who behave like that. Who's just they're just fun to watch and fun to have in the breeding room. So the sky was a key bird for me. He bred easy over 30 chicks, maybe 35 chicks from 5 different hens. Quality birds from every hen I paired him to. A number of shield winners and sky spangles that ran 6 in the nationals. And very strong birds from him, maybe. A big portion of the breeding team I have today would be his sons and daughters.
Yeah, from so different obviously hens. That light green hen comes down from him.
So that light green hen is a daughter from him paired to one of the hens I bred out of the Glen Schiller Spangle Cock paired to a sister of the Mackay. So remember the pairing
yes. Yep.
We looked at, and I said there was a number of hens, big, powerful hens, and I can't put them all. So that's from one of these hens paired to the sky.
And did you pair her up to Pretty Boy by the look of it?
Yes, and I just got the one chick, which is a pretty good chick. I'm very happy with that bird.
Yep.
And I'm happy that it's a cockbird now, given that the father is no more. But this pairing wasn't just the light green hens. She has a number of brothers, probably just 80-90% as good as her. But that was good enough for two of them to run second in the shield in light green and spangles, and another one to run third in the spangles. So that's, and she ran first in the light green as a UBC. So that's 4 out of 6 birds I bred out of the pairs at the top 3 in Victoria, you know?
That's a pretty good representation of a family if you can get them that high up in the
pictures
you have.
There were 2 that were at least as good as the light green hens that lost their heads in the nest under 2 different pairs. That was heartbreaking, but that's the dark side of the hobby, you know? Anyway,
so down the bottom here we've got a Bob Smith cock by the look of it, and the grey green hen.
Again, I want to say something about that Bob Smith cock.
Yep.
I knew Bob Smith as a breeder. By that time I was 6 years into the hobby, and I knew who's who. So I knew the quality he breed. I knew his standards. So I was chasing Bob Smith birds when he sold out, but they were going for too much. So I was sitting there waiting for one to land cheap. I landed this cock for $500, all right? So, and I didn't look at it. And it was a Twinham auction. So, and now it's a foundation bird in this line. And the hen that was the foundation for the Spangle line, again, she was around this sort of money as well. There is something there that sometimes you just don't have to go for the one that everyone goes for. You just, probably the lesser brother or sister will breed more chicks. And in this quantity, you will find chicks that will be as good and better than the fancy ones.
Well, let's have a look at the light green hen that you bred through the sky blue cock here down from the green line. Tell us a bit about her and what you like about her.
I like this hen. I like her probably more than anything because just quite big, and she's got the thickness right through the body. So you can see she's, I know the standard calls for a carrot shape. I wouldn't say she's a carrot shape. She's just thick right through, like a can of Coke, if you like. And I just like this thickness, especially if you look at the neck area and the back skull area. So yeah, and the masks, the width of the mask is also something that I quite like about her. If you compare her to the other two birds, you'll find that she's a lot more advanced in the mask area.
She's a lovely hen. I think if I was to pick any fault with her, the only thing I'd say is that she's not in my aviary. So yeah. I haven't sold it to me yet.
Well, you had a light green that was good too. I don't know.
Hang on a second, Chris. You're the host here. Wally's accidentally shared his screen. I'll just share mine. Again. Sorry. All right. So we'll look at some birds inside of this.
So this is the family. So that is the, on the top right, so that's the original, that's the Bob Smith light green cock, and that's the sky blue as a baby, so that's just him after doing his first molt. You can see the influence from the Jeff Edwards stuff is just a little bit wider but flatter in the head. That's the sky spangle, that's his son. Gray-green hen is sister.
This sky blue here?
Yep.
And that's her again there, right?
That's her again. Gray spangle hen is a daughter to the skycock at the bottom right. Dark green spangle is a son of the same Bob Smith cock. Only bred one chick from him, so we'll see. That's a light green hen, that's one of her brothers. That's that big light green cock, that is out of the one of the sister to the gray cock, which is a big spangle hen. Paired to the light green, paired to the Bob Smith cock, and that's the chick that eventually bred me Magic Pudding. So 2-3 generation down the line.
Yep.
Get me that
Magic
bird,
Pudding which, being down here.
Yep. Which is the bird that breeds me the good, that's currently breeding me the good chicks. Spangle gray, opaline gray hen, one again a chick out of the sky cock from one of the earlier pairings. Spangle on the right is out of the sky cock from another pairing. Second pairing, I would say light green is from a third pairing.
Look it over to this one. Tell us a little bit about these. So we can see obviously here, this is where you've yep. crossed the two lines.
Yeah, that's a crossing from the two line. The one on the left is actually from the dark green spangle cock. So he's the father of the lucky square bird.
But Danny's fist pumping again right now.
Yep. So
very nice.
Yeah.
And the beauty of these photos, Edra, is we can really see that feather texture. You can see it down here on these birds. Yeah, it's so really coming through.
That's quite a big bird. I will show him in the next videos. And he's the son of the dark green cock, dark green spangle. He's the only chick. He's quite fertile, nearly as good as his dad. But I still can't get anything at the same level of quality from him. So it could be another case of the quality skipping a generation. So, but I'll keep trying him on different hens, and usually one of the hens will click and it will come out. Otherwise, I'll just work with those chicks and see what comes out.
I'm sure if it clicks from the Lucky Squares bird, you'll be hearing from Danny. But let's have a little bit of a look at your bird room setup now. If you want to walk us through your aviary here?
Yeah, so my aviary, my bird room is obviously at the back of the garage. So this is now, this is my second or third setup now. So the property was an old house, had a big garage. Everything in these old houses are a bit oversized. That's one thing about them. So I managed to cut the back 2.5 meters with a partition wall. And you can see the roller door and converted that into a bird room. So that's your typical garage with the brick piers. I cut this window because it was too dark. So I cut this window and introduced the window there. Added a sink, fridge. That's it. Wire cages hung on the wall.
Tell us a little bit about these products you're using here.
So this is what I'm using on a daily basis. I use Nekton on my soft food. It was actually Bob Smith who introduced me to the Nekton. That's what he used for his birds. So if it was good enough for him, so I decided to keep this feeding program. I use F10. The hand pump is quite handy if you hold an outcross or a bird, and maybe you just put a pump before you hold another bird. Liquid gold is calcium before pairing up. For a few weeks, I have it 2-3 days. Aviform Force 13, another product that I use. I don't know if it works or not, but things have been going well in the last 2 years, so I don't want to change too much. In the fridge, I've got my Quick Gel, my Turbo Boost. Turbo Boost goes on the soft food, my Spark, my rearing formula. Protex in there, F-Vite, E-Powder, Moxie-T, KD-Powder, Metros, Megamix. Yeah, just basic stuff that everyone use.
Nice. Why don't you walk us through your ovaries here, Hedra?
So when you walk out of the roller door, there's a pergola, and then I've closed this off and converted the pergola into a flight. So that's the other side of the bird room now. And you walk in till the end, you've got the roller door, and you walk out, and then it opens up to the flight. And there's a little shed on the right where I keep all the junk. Flight is about 3.5 by 3.5. I keep all the birds together, old, young, cocks, hens, keepers, culls, feeders. There's a lot of bush budgies there or pet birds there too. So yeah, everything together makes it easy to clean and maintain. And I think better for the birds, more natural. I have the big pop-out section. It's something good for the birds, but also something for my own enjoyment to see the birds getting out there and jumping around. Some of the birds in the flight, that big opaline is from one of the hens, one of the birds I swapped with Craig. I'm very happy with him. Birds were in a big molt when I've done this video, unfortunately. That's a Spangle Cock from the Spangle line. Gray-green hen. That's one of the birds mix from the two lines as well. Bred a lot of strong chicks. Now, at that time of the day, the sun hits the floor and the birds go down and enjoy the sun on the floor. So this is some of the babies. Opaline hen is about 7-8 months. Light green cock, also very late bred. Is another one of the chicks out of Magic Pudding. Light green Spangle Cock in the corner there, chatting with the normal light green. He's also a baby, about 7-8 months out of Magic Pudding too. Bred a dominant pied there, nothing special, but not a bad start. That's one corner. Another corner there, a couple of Spangle Cocks running around. So we've got two, the one in the corner is one of the chicks from Magic Pudding. The opaline spangle next to him is one of the brothers to Pretty Boy.
Very good birds there, Hendra.
Not bad, yeah. More birds. There's another corner. So when I've done this, the birds were just into second week into the doxy course and usually break into a big molt when you start them on the doxy course. So this was the time. So a lot of pin feathers.
I think you can see the quality of the birds there very clearly.
Yeah. I hope so.
Most definitely.
So if you look at the birds that came over the milk crate there, this one, that's magic pudding there. So just a big buffy thing. He was just out of the breeding cage. So just breaking into the molt now.
Tell us a little bit about the seed mix you're using there, Hendra.
Your normal use a seed called Maxi Seed. We get it from the Melton Club. So this is the seeds that our club members get. We buy it in quantities, and I get it from Carmel, from Aussie Seed and Supplies. Just nothing special, nice clean seed. I add oats to it. I add the cod liver oil, and I add the tamarite. I add tamarite as well to the seed.
Yeah, but they're using the Himalayan rock salt up there, I can see.
Himalayan rock salt. I give them a dish, always a dish full of the Avismart Breed Plus, which I get from Troy Holmes. I get the minerals. Yeah, very good product, the Avismart. If you short on time, can do fancy soft food, this kind of does the same. Keeps them happy. Yeah, so that dish there is the...
And what are the little balls you've got running around on the floor there?
Ah, these are just toys. So he carries them around and these are just toys. And quite often also, I would, every 2-3 days, I would just go and bring a big gum tree branch and throw it to them in the flight, and they love it. And also every 2-3 days, I would just put a big dish full of water for bathing. Sometimes I put KD powder in that. Sometimes I just put, in the summer times, I put S76 in the bathing water.
Okay.
Yeah.
Let's have a look at a couple of your different variety birds here.
Yeah, yeah.
That's what we're looking at here.
So some of the young, not young, some of the light greens. So I've had some good light greens. I've been a bit consistent with the light greens, which was again, just come out of the spangle. I always try and pair, if there is a gray green, I always try and pair it to a light green. So most of my gray green and gray green spangles, if not all of them, would be split from light greens. So when you pair these birds, you always get a good percentage of light green and light green spangles. So keep doing that. And over 3 or 4 years, I'm breeding more light greens and light green spangles than gray greens now. And they are stronger than the gray greens. So I'm really not sure about if the quality is really attached to the gray factor or not.
You think it's just more a case of putting the better birds through them?
Yeah.
So how old are the ones that we're looking at here?
So the one on the left, that is 7-8 months old. He's a bit rough. So this one there is a 2020 ring, so that one in the middle here. He ran second in the shield, the one in the middle. This one is still just, I think, doing his first malt.
Okay. Green tea.
Yeah, so that the one on the left is a bit ticked, but there's a bit of mystery this one because he came out of two clean birds and he's a good sized bird. So I said I'd give him a go and I had chicks from him from two different hens, all clean. So that was a relief. That's a gray green hen that's breeding good chicks for me. The one, this one is a 2020 bird. Haven't used it yet. Big shoulder hen, quite thick.
Edgar, when you look at a bird like that, would you consider her to be the wider feathered bird or the longer feathered bird?
Definitely white feathered bird. Definitely. So that these are the ones that if I think. I'm not 100% sure, but if you pair her to a similar looking bird, similar that you double with the intention to double up on this width, so directional feather, I think the birds will get small and even shorter in the feather. So this is a type of hen that I will take and pair to a long and narrow feathered bird with a deep mask and tucked in beak, but very blowy. So something like that has the potential to produce something special.
Well, it's a very cinnamons here we're looking at.
They are not much at all. So, but most of them are hens. So a lot of good cinnamon hens. Can't breed a good cinnamon cock, but a lot of good cinnamon hens.
Yeah, where would you put that hen with her blow? Is she a wider feathered bird or is she a longer feathered bird?
She's more on the, she's more towards the white feathered. So yeah, that one here.
Yep.
But the one on her right, she's definitely a white feathered bird. So she needs to go into, so when I pair her, I would be looking for something long and very blowy to get that cap feather sitting tight over the cap to get it out in the air. Yeah. So the double factors. This hen there on the right, that's a granddaughter to the big gray cock. One of the few descendants I have of this bird. I like her very much. She has a nice face. She's quite big, but she's quite stylish as well for her size. And that's her daughter, 2021 rank daughter on the left. So we'll see how good the daughter will be.
So she's obviously bred well for you?
Look, she lays big clutches, but my cockbirds hasn't been doing a great job with her. So yeah, haven't yet had the best from her yet. Hopefully this spring. So that's another white feathered bird, the double factor hen. So sitting tight over the head. So we'll try and find a very blowy cock bird for her.
Tell us about these cinnamon opalines.
Yeah, cinnamon. I bred like half a dozen good cinnamon opaline hens last year, so hopefully they will be a good force in the breeding team. This one is in a big molt now, ran third in Victoria as well. That is the one that was featured in the presentation. She's a sister to Pretty Boy, not this one, that one. Yeah. So one of my favorite young hens, this one. And I haven't bred many good hens last year, actually. So yeah, We're just waiting patiently for her to be ready. First time is, no, not first time actually, but yeah, not showing very well.
They have a habit of doing that when you don't want them to.
Yeah, but she's a good bird. Always looking away from the camera for some reason.
She's a lovely blowy bird, isn't she?
Yeah, you can. If you can't breed a good chick from a hen like that, you probably won't. Yeah.
Probably need to give the game away. Is that what you want to say?
That's a message to myself, Matt.
All right, some of your spangles. Let's talk through these two boys.
Light green spangles, yeah. So that's a cousin to Pretty Boy. So from the big light green cock out of the Craig Barnett hen and the gray-green spangle cock. Nice stylish bird. This one there, that's the big spangle out of Magic Pudding with his dodgy tail. So more light green spangles. I put him in the show cage. You can't see his face, but because of the molt, but you can still see him in proportion. These two are brothers to the good light green hen. So the one on the right, he ran third in the shield. The one on the left, he ran second. So they are two full brothers. So just the ones that were in acceptable condition, you know. I still put this one in the show cage because I thought people may.
Yeah, he's certainly a lovely budgie.
He's not small.
All right, so let's have a look at your gray-green spangles. Talk us through these birds, Hedra.
Different generations, so... So I think what we've got there on the right, that's a very late bred 2020 hen. That's a 2018 cock. This is a, can't remember, 2018 or 2019 cock. That's the father of Lucky Square. It's quite big and very strong through the neck and shoulder area. Don't think he grows a tail. He's a very strong budgie. Still hasn't got anything of the same level from him, but good news, he's fertile. So keep trying different hens.
Yeah.
This is an old bird, actually. That's a son from the original pair. Still fertile. But just shows maybe 2020, 2018, 2019, and the bird on the very left, on the very right, he probably would be 2017. So 3-4 generations there.
Yep. Nice. Any cinnamon spangles?
Yep. So the one on the right, that's another son from Magic Pudding. Yes, this one, this cinnamon spangle has actually four good chicks in the nest at the moment. Cinnamon spangle hen, that's a very young one too. So these two are youngsters, the cock and the hen. And these are, I think, 2019 hens.
got some good length about them.
Yeah, not some shoulder about them, I think. Yeah. See that one? That's a very short feathered bird, short and white feathered birds. Good directional feather, good show bird. But to me, it needs to go to a very blowy cob bird.
All right, last but not least, we've got your opaline spangles.
Yes. Yes, very strong birds, the opaline spangles. So that hen there, that's the gray-green on the right, the gray-green, that's Pretty Boy's mother, and that's his brother there, the opaline spangle.
Ooh.
Yeah. Very fertile too. That's another one from the spangle family, big girl. She was lined up for Newcastle auction, this one. But then when the auction was cancelled, I decided to breed with her this year.
Oh, we've got a good solution for that. The BSSA is running a 32 auction. I'm sure we could slip her in.
Yeah, yeah. Yeah. So
famous plug there for the BSSA auction.
Yeah.
He's very nice.
Yeah, I like him too. I like him too. He's a good stock bird, this one. And that's the mother, and you can see the sort of birds, like you wouldn't say that this bird has any wits, but she's a very long feathered bird if you study her feather, and she's very blowy. And the father of these birds, the Cinnamon of Glen Schiller, I had him, he's what you call a modern feathered bird, and I had him with a lot of hens that look the same. He's got the directional feather, the downward feather, if you like, and I couldn't breed a good chick. They were all too small. And I pair him to the long feathered hens that didn't have any directional feather, and bang, fireworks. So.
That's exactly what you want. It's a good outcome.
Yeah.
All right, let me clear my screen here. Just go into the chat real quick. Okay. Let me see what questions we've had fired at us while we've been talking. So, being asked, Hedra, did your feeding regime in the cabinets match what you were doing in the aviaries?
Yes. So, I still do the standard seed mix in one of the jars. I still give the Avismart Breed Plus Pro. I give more minerals in the finger drawers, and I have a separate jar of oats. So I feed oats, more oats in the separate oats in the for the breeding pairs. I find they consume a lot of oats when they are feeding chicks.
Yeah. Got another question here. It says, how long or often do you put the doxy on? You mentioned that you had them on the doxy there.
I'm not sure myself, so I'm not sure if I even need to do that, but I just do it because I'm used to do it and I get results. So I don't want to change.
You put them on it for like a week or 2 weeks or?
30 days.
30 days.
That's okay. My standard practice. I can't back it up, but that's what I do.
Yep. Okay. Got a question here from Wayne Whedon off where he said, Hedra, you obviously have a strong conviction to resisting using flecked bird. Very limited in your stud. Would that be a true statement?
Now, yes. 3-4 years ago, maybe 4-5 years ago, it was the other way around. Okay, so you can turn it around.
Yep. When does your breeding season start or finish, or is it just continuous through the year?
Look, I think the start and finish depends on the setup. So mine gets too hot in summer and too cold in winter. So I just try and breed in between. So I breed in mid-seasons in autumn and spring. Just have to adapt.
Yeah. What do you generally breed in a year? Like what would a typical season be for you? How many birds?
100 birds a year is very common for me, but there are exceptions. So last year I was locked up at home and business activity was down. So I had more time for the budgies. I bred 190. That was my best ever. This year I'm very busy. I'm probably lucky if I breed 100 this year.
Yeah. What sort of hours of artificial lighting do you use?
Comes on around 7 o'clock, and then I give them it goes off around 12, 1 o'clock, then back on around 4 o'clock. So, and then goes up till 10 o'clock again.
And how many rounds would you generally take off a pair during the breeding season?
That will depend on the condition, and especially the hens would be the driving factor. There's some hens, look, I'll be honest, my homebred hens, especially the long feathered ones, tend to need a break after one round. I get hens from breeders like Craig Barnett or Johnny Ennis, and they will do 3 rounds in a row and wouldn't blink.
You mentioned your pairing strategy for the birds. You mentioned blow and whip. Can you tell us a little bit about any other pairing strategies you might have, a common bird or something there that you use?
Look, it's always good to have a common bird in the background. So that kind of, so if the birds share the same grandfather or great grandfather, you will see some consistent traits coming in the chicks. So yeah, the difference between the best and the worst in the nest wouldn't be too much. So I always try and breed back to certain key birds or key pairs.
You mentioned back there when we were talking, you mentioned about your experience with quality, skipping a generation. Do you want to tell us a little bit more about that?
Look, when I look at the best pairs I've ever put, not on pedigree, on visuals, when you put two birds that are super visually, you generally, what I find is that I generally get birds that are less than the original birds. I used to get rid of them, but now I learned to hang on to them and breed with them. Because paired to something related again, it will come back, definitely.
Yep. We've got a question here from Trent. He said, is there any faults that you won't tolerate? Bad wings, flicking?
There are many faults that I wouldn't tolerate, but mainly bad wings. Flicking on a hen, I would tolerate, but not on a cock bird.
About the frames.
Look, if the birds are, I have no problem using a short and strong shouldered bird, a cubby bird, but I wouldn't use a bird that is very narrow through the body or very, very slim, very cylinder, like a pencil. Especially the ones that you hold them in the hand and they have got no bulk or substance, I try and stay away from them. I find it hard to breed big chicks out of them. There are birds that can look small in the show cage, but you hold them in the hand and they're quite robust. And especially if they are hens, these hens usually breed good sized chicks, even though they may not look big.
Okay. Weedo's asked through here, you talked about feather problems when progressing the head feather length and width. How do you address those no tail issues?
You just breed more of them and lucky you'll get one with tail.
And you told the other ones?
If they have got no cysts, if they've got cysts, any sort of cysts or unhealthy ingrown type feathers, bleeding, anything like that, I would cull them straight away. If they have got no tails but no cysts and generally healthy. Otherwise, I would use them if they are top quality.
How close do you go with your inbreeding? Do you pair cousins? Do you pair half brother, half sister?
I pair cousins, never, but not any closer than cousins. No half brother, no half sisters. I do the occasional uncle to niece, nephew to auntie. But when I do that, the next generation has to go very far.
What are you setting out to improve in your stud this season?
I'm very short on time for the budgets this year, so my expectations are quite low this year. I just want to breed some chicks that are as good as my 2020 birds and 2019 birds, so that I've got birds of the same quality and young and fit to carry the stud forward next year. And hopefully next year, when I've got a bit more time, we'll try and breed more numbers and have more things.
But you want to consolidate the quality?
Consolidate the quality and keep it going and keep the stud young.
Yeah. I've got a question from Rob here, and he's asking, do you have any recommendations on going about cleaning up the saddle on the opalines?
I don't know. Just use opalines with clean saddle.
It's using the cleaner variety birds.
Yeah, that's
yep. Right. No, that makes sense. There's a question here, and it says dry soft food mix details. So what you are feeding as your dry soft food. So I think you mentioned that was the AbbySmart, correct?
AbbySmart Breed Plus Pro, yeah. That's, to me, I call it soft food replacement.
Yep.
Okay.
Okay. There's a question here from Jason, and it says, why don't you breed any of the lesser varieties? If you did, what would they be?
I will definitely do that later in life. I just come back from work 7-8 o'clock, and then I've got the kids and the family and so many other things. So when I have a bit more time, I'm certainly looking forward to breeding some of the lesser varieties. And
Wayne Wheaton offers asked there, is there a rare variety that particularly takes your fancy?
I am actually trying having a go at the dominant pieds, but this is probably not a lesser variety. There are some magnificent ones out there. But after that, I'm not too sure. I like lace wings.
You're not going to try and do a Gary Gazzard and breed black eyes or something like that as a little side hobby, clear wings?
Well, when...
Didn't you play tie at Nationals with a crest?
Yeah. No, I stay away from black eyes. I think, it's very hard to get the variety right on black eyes. I think that's my view.
Okay, nice. Sue Adams is just asking, what do you put in your water? And I think she's probably keen to find out also what you put in your budgies water.
So in the breeding cages, I put nothing, just clean, fresh water.
Yep.
Due to the fact that I only change the water in the breeding cages twice a week. I don't want anything that can go off. In the fly though, I change the water daily. So I just have a cycle where I put, it depends what you're doing, but let's say if in a normal time, not on any medication course, whether winter or summer, they would be getting 1 day calcium. Next day they would be getting phosphatidine, which is energy supplement and vitamin B. And then the following day, they would be getting Oregostim, which is just general immunity supplement. And then the fourth day, they get fresh water.
Okay.
And then repeat the cycle again.
Fair enough. Shifting gears a little bit, let's talk about beginners coming into the hobby. You mentioned about the creation of your lines. You actually did on a fairly tight budget, being very controlled in your spending and and what you brought in. What advice would you recommend to a beginner today, and what could they do to best learn?
Well, I just tell them maybe just take your time. It's I understand we all, when we start, we have the growing pains and we have to start somewhere. And we probably all end up starting with birds from all over the place. But just observe different birds, different lines, different breeders. Take your time to see, to learn what are the different styles and what are the different lines, the dominant lines, and what they produce and all that. It's important to have your own view on what sort of budgie you want to breed. I think that will set the directions. It will set the game plan. And once you've had this vision, and I don't think you can have this vision the moment you walked into the hobby. I think this vision will evolve in the first couple of years, maybe. And once you figured out what sort of budgie you want to breed, look for the breeders who consistently produce this sort of budgie, not a one-off here and there, many, many of them. And try and get as many birds as you can from this breeder, preferably more than one, like two or three. And you may be able to do it directly from the breeder, but if not, you can do it in the auctions. Again, don't go for the fancy ones that everyone wants. Probably the lesser brother or sister from the same family will do you just as well. And then once you create that base from this line, you will have a lot of consistency. You won't be dealing with a lot of faults. Then you start breeding your own ingredient, which can be a form of an outcross to bring in one specific feature to evolve this line, to create your own version of that line. And yeah, work on slow incremental improvements. Over 5-6 years, you will see big improvement, and you will see that your own birds are breeding better birds than the birds you buy from outside. So what I'm trying to say is you have to get out of the habit of buying birds. It's okay at the start, but you need to get out of this phase. Form your own vision and try and get out of this phase after a few years and start working with your own lines.
So that's a good explanation of how to get, like your recommendation to beginners of what we should do to get them to learn. What would you recommend on the flip side of that? What can we do to encourage new members in the hobby? So us as open champion breeders and clubs, what do you think we can do better?
Look, getting new members into the hobby is a tricky topic, because you can try all marketing techniques, but it's a big undertaking. When you have the budgies, it's people need to know what they are signing up for. You know, it's a wonderful hobby, and especially in these strange times we're living, there's no better hobby to be doing at home. But it's a big commitment. It will limit your travel. It will limit things. So I think the hobby needs to grow organically. So someone comes and visits Hedra. Oh, what are you doing? Oh, look what I have in the backyard. Oh, that's wonderful. Okay, just that's what you need. You can see what sort of setup. Do you want to try some birds? And some will like them, some will won't. But once people come into the hobby, at least we should be able to retain them. And the retention can be through mentorship programs. Yeah, there's every club has some established breeders who can take one or two beginners under the wing, and even helping them with advice and feedback. That will go a long way.
Okay. Tell me, in the decade that you've been in exhibition budgies here in Australia, what have you seen as the most significant change?
The best change that I've seen was the evolution of the modern birds in Victoria. So when I've started 9 years ago, the birds in Victoria has changed significantly from the birds I'm seeing today. There are many breeders who are breeding what you would call the modern style budgie, and they are very good at it. And it's an absolute pleasure to be in the Shield in Victoria and see the depths of quality in most classes. On the flip side, I look at the breeders we had when I started, the Welshman, Bob Smith, these type of guys, absolute legends, went out of the hobby. So we've got big shoes to fill as new generation of breeders.
No, I couldn't agree more. Now, I've had a couple of questions come through on the chat while we're just talking about beginners there. Someone has asked, do you do any greens or soaked food regime? And if you do, is it soaked oats or mung beans?
I don't do any greens because of the way my setup is, I get some moisture on the floor when it rains. So, and that doesn't work well with any sort of veggies laying around. So I stopped doing any veggies. Yeah. In terms of the soft food, I do it on the weekend just to spoil the birds. Not that I think it makes any difference. It just makes me feel good.
Yeah.
So I have a number of egg and biscuit products. I mix them with the Turbo Boost, Nekton, depends on what time of the breeding cycle it is. Could be Nekton.
It's a bit of variety you put in there.
Yeah, a mix of vitamins, minerals, probiotics, all the things that you can see on Facebook.
Yeah.
Sorry, on YouTube. There are YouTube videos, I think, the Millers, the Martin Halen, Daniel Luthor, they've all done this and whatever. I try to copy that, basically.
Okay. One of the questions that's come through, how often do you outcross? And is it to bring in a specific feature?
Outcrossing is a tricky one because I'm a very impatient person. And usually, I haven't been having luck with outcrosses in the last 2-3 years. So, but I'm learning now, and I'm finding that when you outcross, you have to accept that you're gonna lose some of the features that you've accumulated in your birds. You just have to accept that, and then you get over yourself and you use this the best of these birds and pair them back to your birds, and then in the second generation you will start seeing the benefit. You'll start seeing your features coming back. Plus that something, that feature from the outcross, you start seeing, you're getting a little bit of that on top of your original qualities in your birds.
Yeah, that makes good sense. You mentioned that you have two family lines running in parallel. How long did the families run before you crossed them over?
Well, in the first 3-4 years, they were running separate because basically wasn't enough of them to cross and they were still forming. But now you kind of hit a dead end with them. So eventually it happens when you've got enough. Okay, I've got this pair. I only work with 6 to 10 pairs. So I've got 3 pairs from the green line, 3 pairs from the spangle line. Now let's put a couple of mixed pairs to see what happens. So So I guess the answer is you have to keep some, as long as you can keep some family pure, some as pure from the two families and mix some, I think that would be a good way to go.
Yep. I think we'll finish up here. Mark Fellows has just written in, and it's not entirely a question, but it says, birds would be very proud of Tedra. In my opinion, one of the leading studs in the country. Thanks for taking us the time to show us your lovely birds. Don't change whatever you're doing. And I look forward to catching up when COVID's a memory.
That's very humbling. Thanks.
Thank you very much for joining us tonight. We'll hand back over to Chris now.
Thanks, Tim. Thanks.
Very much appreciate it.
All good. Thanks.